Does Alpha Vantage's long short-term model help predict stock prices using deep learning? Hi, my name is Everett Minchell, and I'm an aspiring machine learning engineer. And in today's video, I wanted to spend some time on Alpha Academy's long short-term memory stock predictor. This is a tutorial they have on their site, which predicts the stock price using deep neural networks. And if you're unfamiliar with machine learning or artificial intelligence, deep learning is just a subset of artificial intelligence. It's quite amazing that they have this tutorial on their site that anyone can clone and use on their own. I thought I'd go ahead and make a video on how it works and how effective it really is. Again, this is something that's completely cloned from their website. I'll link it in the description where you can go and check it out yourself, but I've loaded it into a Jupyter notebook and we're gonna go ahead and see how well it performs, go through a little bit of the code and explain what's going on to some degree. This isn't gonna be a long video. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but I thought it would be a good learning exercise to showcase because I think typically something like this would be, I don't know, pretty valuable that's just sitting here on the internet for anyone to use. So I have it already written out. You can tell the first kernel is always going to be the packages that we'll need to import. Let's go ahead and run that. The second kernel is going to be a nested dictionary with all of our variable inputs. This is just good practice for when we want to change one element of the variable. We don't have to go through our entire code and find each instance that we use that variable. We can just call it here in these nested dictionaries. So you can see under Alpha Advantage, I have the key, which is blurred out, but this is my key registered with AlphaVantage that allows me to connect with its API. Here's the symbol. We're going to be looking at IBM for now because that's what was used in default code. Output size is full. It just refers to how much data that we're pulling. And key adjusted close is the part of the data frame that we're going to be using the most. In previous iterations of me going through this code, I've used not adjusted because I'm still a little unsure about the difference between regular close and adjusted close, but I think it has to do with accounting for variances with dividend prices, opening and closing, or after hour price changes, or something like that. The data in the plots has to do with training the data that we'll be pulling later down in the model. Plotting just helps us plot the data points because we're going to be making graphs along the way. These are some variables for the long short-term model and as well as the training that we'll be using for the model. So let's go ahead and run this dictionary. Next, we've created a function called download data. This is just getting the data from the API and reversing it because it typically comes in chronological order, but we want to train the data moving from the end of the data moving forward to the present. Put that in an array, and we're going to separate out the data into different time ranges and number of data points, closing price, as well as the dates. And we're going to go ahead and plot it. Take a look at the data. You can see here we're pulling data from November 1st, 1999 to November 15th, 2022, which is the day I'm recording this. So we have a pretty good graph here of IBM's adjusted closing price, just so we have an idea of what kind of time series line that we're looking at. We're then going to normalize our data. Normalizing is an important part of machine learning. If you have two different data points on different scales, you want that to be normalized so it's on the same scale. This is really important. Say if one part of your data is in grams and another part of your data for a different variable is in kilograms, obviously, when you go to train, the model is going to be a little confused on what those metrics are. So you just normalize the data so that it's all standardized. It's not super important to know. It is extremely important when it comes to data science. For the purposes of this tutorial, it's not something I need to dive too deeply into. But just know that what we're doing here is making the data, is scaling the data and normalizing it. Here we're preparing the data. So we're going to split it into X and Y. The X is going to be our training data and the Y is going to be our validating data, or excuse me, we're just going to split the data so that it's one portion of the timeline is going to be training, another portion of the timeline is going to be validation, and it's taking through all of our prepared data that's normalized, and the closing price and the window size is all defined in the nested dictionary as well. We're going to split that data up, as I said, into train and validation, or sometimes called train and test. And then we're going to prepare it for plotting. So this is what it looks like plotted. The green line is the training data where our model will take a look at to help make predictions. The blue line is going to be where the model makes a predictions and we're going to evaluate how close it gets to the actual price. And then later, we're also going to make predictions about what the future state of the adjusted close price is going to be. So this is a class function that's going to help prepare our data set to be loaded into the model. We've sort of condensed things into a train and validation. We're going to see the shape of those two data sets that are being loaded into the LSTM. So let's go ahead and run that. Going to give us the shape here. Quite a lot of data points, as you can see. Again, not super important to know. It's just another necessary procedure to help the model understand the data. So this is the model itself. It's a class of several functions. I'm not going to dive too deep into what each line is doing here because it does require quite a lot of background knowledge. And to be honest, even this model is a little beyond my comfort zone. I do know the basic levels of how it works, but to dive deeper into it would require more time. It's outside of the purview of this video. But just know that these functions here are the neural network itself. Let's go ahead and run that. You can think of an epoch as the model learning. It's sort of like taking one step forward and evaluating, and then taking another step forward and evaluating. Just trying to find the best learning path forward. Sometimes it's worse, sometimes it's better, but we're going to run 100 epochs to train our data. Again, I'm not going to run too much into this because you can see there's quite a few lines of code here and it requires quite a lot of background knowledge, but just trust that this is sort of the learning part of the model. You can see here that it's going to run through an epoch. You can see that the learning rate is not going to change much. It's going to be this like 0.01, but let's just wait until it gets done with 100. It's been trained, it's evaluated everything. So let's go ahead and check out our data and see how well the model actually did. All right, so it's hard to tell, but there is actually three lines here. Green is our training data, as before. Blue is the validation aspect of the data. And black is the actual prices. So what that means is, since the black, green, and blue are all pretty much layered on top of each other, you can't really tell where one begins and the other ends. It means that the predicted prices, since it overlays the black line almost perfectly, shows that it's doing really well. But it would help to get a close up on how well it did in the portion of the data that the model hadn't seen before to see how close it really was. So let's zoom in on that portion of the data. And you can see it's pretty close, it's pretty perfect. I mean, you can kind of see where it's black in certain areas, but this is pretty good. So I just want to reiterate what we're looking at here. The black line is the actual price and the blue line is the predicted price. So in this set, what we're looking at here is our validation portion of our data set, meaning that we know what the actual price is, but the blue line is the predicted price that the model made. So it had never seen this price before. It was just predicting based on the green line that it was trained on. So you can see, since it's overlaying the black pretty well, it is able to predict the adjusted close price fairly accurately. So this next portion of the kernel is going to be evaluating what we think the next day's price is going to be. So it's going to zoom in on this very tail end up here in the top right of the graph where it ends. It's going to zoom in really close to here. It's going to show the difference between the two predicted and actual price, and then a red dot will be the predicted adjusted close price for tomorrow's close. So let's go ahead and see what that looks like. And you can see it's really close. I mean, the blue is the predicted value, black is the actual price. So the model thinks that tomorrow's closing price will be $142 for IBM. It's probably not going to be that unless this just drops really hard, but we could just say, well, maybe tomorrow's closing price for IBM is going to just be up here and it'll be closer to $145 or something like that. Pretty accurate based on that. But that's IBM. Let's go ahead and test something a little sexier and see what it comes up with. Instead of IBM, let's do Tesla. Start and run all, and let's see what happens. Now you can see here that this is not as close as the IBM model. This is like way down in the, just above 80, and it's pretty flat. I mean, it doesn't interweave or cross the black line like it did with IBM. Didn't see the dip here. And if we go ahead and look at the other graph that shows how closely the predicted, which is the blue line, and the actual, you can see it wasn't close sometimes by a whole ton. I mean, almost, this is up here by 300. This is down by 100, so it's a $200 difference in stock prediction. Same can be said up here in the peak of over $400. Still thinks it's around $100, so it just flatlined by the time it got to the validation portion of the data set, which is pretty interesting. Yeah, you can see it trained well, but then by the time it got to 07 of 2020, you just could see it could not understand what to predict for Tesla in the actual prices. And I've gone ahead and checked out several different kinds of stocks before making this video, like Apple and Microsoft and some other FANG stocks out there, and it's a similar result. For some reason, IBM seems to work really well. Microsoft seemed to work a little bit better, but yeah, I mean, it's not the most reliable. It definitely, like, IBM seemed to have very good data where it allowed it to learn pretty well. Thing about Tesla is that the stock price doesn't go back to 1999. It starts at 2010. That's probably a real huge reason for why it doesn't learn as well on that stock. So that's something to keep in mind. Companies like Microsoft and Apple do a little bit better, but even IBM goes back farther, and the more data you load into the LSTM model, it will learn better. So does Alpha Vantage's long short-term model help predict stock prices using deep learning? Certainly it does, but it's not a foolproof method, and I certainly wouldn't use it for production, but it's really good to play around with and just help you understand time series data and long short-term modeling. I've certainly had a lot of fun playing around with it and adjusting the parameters to try to find the best fit or the best predictions. But I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you're curious about anything else, please leave a comment. It's a really good way for me to understand what you're looking for. I will see you in the next video. Bye. We'll be right back.